يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. All praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who created this universe and dictated for this universe a beautiful science. As man endeavors to increase his knowledge of science, sciences develop so rapidly, and the more sciences develop, the more man sees himself to be humble in understanding the alameen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After so much technological advance, after so much understanding, man still must confess that he cannot understand in totality the reality of this alameen. And so therefore, it is a logical conclusion that if man cannot understand the alameen, how can man then understand Rabbul Alameen? And it also follows, if man cannot understand the alameen, then man cannot also properly understand Rahmatul Lil Alameen. The more we develop our science, logic, and wisdom to understand the alameen, the more we understand the diversity of the rahmah of Rahmatul Lil Alameen. Today, my discussion will revolve around one simple point, and that point is, what really is Milad? And I'm going to start off by asking you some questions so that we begin to appreciate that this activity known as Milad is not a customary activity just designed for a certain part in the year, but actually it has deep connotations in the development of the mu'min from his cradle to his death. So I want to ask you some very simple questions. Number one, what does Milad mean? What does Milad mean? Birthday. Everybody agree with this translation? Milad means? Come on, let me hear it from you a bit. Milad means? Right. Now, there are certain preconditions when we use the word birthday. One condition, let me ask you a question. Do you celebrate the birthday of someone who is living and someone who is dead? Do you celebrate the birthday of someone who is dead? Are you sure? Grandpa passed away last year. Now we're going to celebrate his birthday. So science tells us birthday is celebrated to commemorate the increase of age, right? And age rests on the idea that the person whose age we are talking about is living. He is? Let me just give you one example which defies this logic. When Isa alayhi salam went to the heavens, do you know how old he was? Approximately 33 years old. And from his departure, up till now, it's been approximately 2,000 years, give or take. I'm not being particular about the exact time, but approximately 2,000 years. So if Isa alayhi salam came, let's say hypothetically, this year, 2005, how old would he be? By the way, you know Isa alayhi salam is physically alive. He hasn't formally died. The flesh and bones are all intact. Yeah, absolutely no problem. But when he comes back, how old will he be? He left at 33, it's been 2,000 years. Come on. Simple, isn't it? But you know what the beauty is? When Isa alayhi salam comes back, he's not going to be 2,033. He's going to be 33 years old. And we will ask him, Isa alayhi salam, where were you living? Or, putting it in more informal terminology, where did you chill out? 2,000 years have gone by and your age hasn't increased. You were 33, 2,000 years later, you still are 33. He will respond that I lived in a zone beyond this earth where my bashariyat, my body, was not restricted to the science of time, which shows that where Allah wants, this body can escape the science of time. But this was the glory of Ruhullah. When it came to Habibullah, on the night of Miraj, he went to a zone where there was no time and there was no space. So science is perfect, but the people of Allah have demonstrated time and time again, they do not need science to operate. Science revolves around them to operate. So the question I was asking you is, do you celebrate the birthday of a dead man? 100% sure? Okay, so one of the preconditions of a birthday is that the person whose birthday you are celebrating must be? Number one. Number two, a very simple question. If in this road on the side, I don't know what the name of the road is, there was a birthday party, would you go to the birthday party? Seriously? Unless you're invited. That's fair enough, isn't it? Unless you're invited. Somebody comes up to you and says, sir, please could you attend? But then part of and parcel of that invitation is that it's not somebody who comes off the road and says, hey, come to my birthday party. You don't know this guy. He's an absolute stranger. If some stranger invites you to a birthday party, you're going to be very cautious, right? This could be leading to something else. Especially if he says, my birthday party is in a warehouse. It may occur to you that there may be an old debt that is being called back. No, I'm only joking. The fact of the matter is, when somebody invites you, the person inviting you, he has to have a connection with you, right? And if you don't have a connection with him, you're going to say, all right, well, I'll see. But if you have a connection with that person, you're going to make a point of going because you've been invited. Fair enough? Okay, now we've got to the point that the person that you're celebrating is alive and he's given you an invitation, you know him, you've got rapport with him. But when you go, tell me one thing, honestly, will you go empty-handed? These people who are not speaking, they're going to go empty-handed. I assure you, it'll be the talk of the town if you go empty-handed. No, when you go, it's customary, it's courteous that you go and you take something with you. But you take something with you subconsciously in the expectation that I'm going to get something back. Maybe not today, but when I do my occasion, I'm going to invite him. And it's going to be reciprocal. Is that fair? That's how birthdays operate, isn't it? Number one, the person whose birthday you celebrate must be alive, and of course, he must have invited you. Or number two, the invitation must have been personal, you must have known him. And number three, you don't go empty-handed. Now let us reflect on this formula when we consider the Milad of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The first question is, why do we call it Milad? After all, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has formally passed away. There is no doubt that he has undergone that process. But by undergoing that process, is he then to be classified as dead? Let's ask Allah. Oh Allah, you tell us that those people who undergo a certain process in your way, what is their status? What is their status? Allah says, وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ قُتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتًا بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يُرْزَقُونَ. Don't even envisage, look at the terminology of Allah, don't even contemplate that those people who die in the way of Allah, who die in the way of
Allah.
What is the way of Allah? What is the way of Allah? What I say or you say? The way of Allah is what His beloved says. The way of Allah is what His beloved says. What is Islam? الَّذِي يَدُورُ مَا حَوْلَ نَبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Islam is everything that revolves around the personality of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So therefore, those who die, who give their lives in the way of Allah, although they have undergone the transitional phase of death, you must not classify them as dead. Why? Because you are looking with your eye, their creator is saying that they are not dead, but they are alive. Now when a scientist proposes a proposition, behind each proposition lies evidence. Now Allah does not need to give us evidence, but look at the evidence He's given us of their life. He says, بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يُرْزَقُونَ. They are alive because Allah consistently feeds them. Now the soul does not need rizq. The soul does not need sustenance. But what requires sustenance is the body. And the Prophet ﷺ said, it is haram for the earth to deteriorate or disseminate the body of a prophet. The way the body of a prophet was when it was buried, in the exact same manner, it will rise on the day of judgment. However, the preservation of the body and the nature of life in that body is something that is beyond our comprehension. But in the end, I'm going to give you a glimpse of the nature of life of our master within his body. There is what you call ruhani life, spiritual life. And then there's what you call jismani life, bodily life. If you say that the Prophet is spiritually alive, that's fine. But that's no big miracle, because even the kafir is spiritually alive. Why? Because the kafir must be spiritually alive to have azab-e-qabr. If there is no life, upon what are you going to give azab-e-qabr? There must be some form of life. And so therefore, this is a different subject as to how the azab comes on the soul and the body when the body is in 1,000 pieces. How the soul comes. But the fact of the matter is, the azab comes on the body and upon the soul. But there must be a concept of life so that there is azab upon. So if you say a Nabi is spiritually alive, this is no big deal. Why? Because even a kafir is spiritually alive. However, when we talk of the life of prophets, and especially of our master, we don't only talk about spiritual life, we also talk about his physical life. And I'm about to tell you the significance of that physical life at this moment, whilst his beautiful body resides in Gumbat-e-Khizra. It certainly rests, but that resting has a function in it. And that function serves not himself. Even that function in Gumbat-e-Khizra serves his ummah. Why? Because the Quran says, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُقِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. My life and my death are for Allah. My life and my death are for? Mahyaya wa mamati. But what about us? The Prophet ﷺ, don't worry. Hayati khayrul lakum wa mamati khayrul lakum. My living is good for you and my dying is good for you. Don't think that you are discriminated in any way, shape or form. Why? Because the way I served my Allah for my ummah whilst I was with them, is similarly I will serve you whilst I'm in my grave. But now we're going to see how that works. You see, it's all very well making a bold assertion that, oh yes, he's alive and yes, he's performing a function. There are many functions which he performs and his prophethood continues. But those functions don't necessarily require his physical body to be operative. Why? Because his physical body is now resting in Gumbat-e-Khizra. But I'm going to talk to you today within the context of this Milad about the function of the physical body of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, I'll leave that to the end. Up till now, I think it's quite acceptable for you to accept the assertion that if a shaheed who gives his life in the way of the deen of Rasulullah, if he gives his life, he is alive, then what about the life of Rasulullah himself? So it's established that he has the label of life. Of course, the transition of death doesn't negate or undermine the reality of his life. He has the label of life. The second question is, you don't go to a birthday without invitation. Did you come here coincidentally? No. Why? Mahbub ki mehfil ko mahbub sajate hai. Aate hai wohi jinko? Are you thinking that there are not other people here in Pretoria? They're very busy today. They've got other commitments. Fair enough. But you came here not out of coincidence. You came here because on the scrolls that were presented in Gumbat-e-Khizra, your name was mentioned on there. Is this just me making a bold assertion, or is this something that can be corroborated from the Quran and the Sunnah? Let me give you two examples. You see, invitation requires person. Now, of course, the Prophet ﷺ's birthday, he needs to see you, he needs to be able to communicate with you. But the Prophet ﷺ and the nature of his physicality wasn't like ours. Why? Because we see that which our eye shows us, right? Where there are no eyes, we cannot see. Or even where there are eyes, we can only see that which is within the range of our eye. Correct? However, this formula doesn't apply to Rasulullah ﷺ. One day he was reading Salah, and after his Salah, Farzi Salah, he turned around and said to one of his disciples, "Ala tuhsin salatak? You didn't read your namaz properly." Now tell me, if your Imam Sahib is reading Jamaat in front of you, and the person in the third row, after Salam, he goes up to him, grabs his hand and says, "You didn't read namaz properly." What's he going to think? He's going to think there's some CCTV around here. That this guy's seeing me. Or you're going to say, where should you have been looking? You say that I didn't read namaz properly? But here the Prophet ﷺ goes up to one of his companions and grabs his arm and says, Allah tuhsan salatak, you haven't read your namaz properly. Now this guy's absolutely confused. Ya Rasulullah, you're standing in front of me, your eyes are there, how can you know my salah? To which the Prophet ﷺ responds, narrated in Bukhari and in Muslim. The Prophet ﷺ says, Wallahi la yakhfa alayya khushu'ukum wala ruku'ukum inni la araakum min wara'i zahri. To say something and you really want to say that you mean it, you say wallahi, isn't it? I swear by Allah. But here the beloved is swearing by the beloved. Wallahi la yakhfa alayya khushu'ukum wa la ruku'ukum. I swear by Allah, your khushu is your internal humility. You know the humility which you have inside you? Not the one which you show outside. That's called khudu. That which is inside is called khushu. So he says, I swear by Allah, your khushu, I that which is within, and your ruku, is not hidden from me. Now if the Prophet ﷺ would have just said this, then somebody would have thought maybe Jibreel would have told him. But no. Look at the last part of the hadith. He says, "Inni la araakum min wara'i zahri." Oh my companions, I see you behind me in the same way I see you in front of me. Your eyes are restricted to that which is in front of you. But, oh my companions, I see you behind me in exactly the same way as I see you in front of me. This is the nature of the physical seeing of the Prophet ﷺ. Now can you imagine, as far as the spiritual vision of the Prophet ﷺ is concerned, some people have this doubt in their mind that maybe he can see us or maybe he can't see us. This maybe is a very dangerous maybe. Why? Very dangerous maybe. Because if you start getting into maybes, then you need to have a discussion with Shaitan. And he will tell you the reality of maybe. Maybe he can see, maybe he can't. Shaitan will say, why do you say maybe, maybe? I can see. Shaitan can see. Who can he see? Maybe? No. Allah says, إِنَّهُ يَرَاكُمْ هُوَ وَقَبِيلُهُ. Shaitan and his disciples see you all wherever you are. So tell me, if Shaitan and his disciples have the power of gazing upon the entire human race, is this a power that is beyond the competence of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? إِنَّهُ يَرَاكُمْ هُوَ وَقَبِيلُهُ مِنْ هَيْثُ لَا تَرَوْنَهُمْ. You don't see them, they see you. Just because you can't see someone, it doesn't mean to say they can't see you. Just because you can't see you doesn't mean... I was in England once and this guy was saying to me, you say the Prophet ﷺ is everywhere? I can't see him. He was looking under the table. I can't see him. You say he's everywhere. I said, you know what? That's excellent. Your posture is just perfect. He said, it means you agree with me? I said, no. On the night of Hijrah, on the night of the Prophet sallallahu, everyone say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was in a house and wanted to depart. And there was guards of the kuffar who wanted to raid him and wanted to give injury to him and kill him. What did he do? Say, Jibreel, here you are, escort me, will you? No. He got a piece of the earth and read something on it. What is dumb? What is dumb? Blowing. He got a piece of the earth and went, pff, read something on it. And when he, of course he could have done it without that, but he wanted to show his ummah the significance of dumb. Right? You know what dumb is, don't you? And he got the earth, piece of earth, and he threw it in their direction. In their direction. They were outside, he was inside, he threw it in their direction. And when he threw it in their direction, he simply opened the door and he left. And the kafirs were standing guard. They were also looking, where is Muhammad? He physically walked past them. But they were looking. Where is he? I didn't see him. So what does it mean? When the beloved wants to show his ummati, he can show his ummati. And when he wants to hide himself, he can hide himself. But ask Allama Suyuti, oh Suyuti, did you see him in your dream? He says, no, I saw him 22 times with these eyes. And yet Allama Suyuti lived many hundreds of years after him. So it means that where the beloved wants to show his physical presence, he can show his physical presence. Of course, it is his discretion. When we mean physical presence at this time, it doesn't mean the original body now comes from Gumbat-e-Khizra. I must clarify this because I want to keep this discussion as clinical as possible. Allah gives his bondsmen what we called Ruh-e-Amsali. Jism-e-Amsali. Bodies that are replica bodies. And the Quran and the Sunnah has many examples of people of Allah coming in bodies that are replica bodies. But this is a different subject. Some other time. What I'm trying to say to you is that the Prophet ﷺ not only sees us, but he sees us and he recognizes us. Are we sure that he recognizes us? Look, I'm seeing all of you at this moment. Very easy. But I don't recognize you all. I recognize some of you. I recognize some people from this place, from that place. One is looking and one is recognizing. Let us have a look from the Quran and the Sunnah whether the Prophet ﷺ is able to recognize each and every one of us individually. On the day of judgment, a person will be escorted to Jahannam. And as the escorts take him to Jahannam, a voice will come from behind. And the voice will say, oh Allah, do not send him to Jahannam. I intercede on his behalf. And Allah will say, who intercedes on the behalf of this person? And the answer the angels will give is, oh Allah, this voice is the voice of Hajre Aswad, the black stone. And Allah will ask, oh Hajar Aswad, on what basis do you intercede on behalf of this Jahannami? Hajar Aswad will say, oh Allah, how are you going to burn this person? This person has kissed me. This person has kissed me. Oh Allah, how are you going to burn him? Tell me, ask your iman, how many billions and trillions of people have kissed Hajar Aswad? But Hajre Aswad has a chemistry, has a biology whereby it not only understands that it is being kissed, but also registers the kiss of every person who kisses it. And not only registers it, it understands the person who has kissed him. So if a stone has the ability to recognize he who kissed it, if a stone has the ability to recognize the person who kissed this stone, do you think it is beyond Muhammadur Rasulullah to understand he who used to love him? What I'm trying to say is that this ability to compress so much knowledge in such short form is not something that is a new thing. Compression of information is something that is that which Allah has ordained from the first day. Why? Because all the information concerning this entire universe from the first day till the last day was written in a database. You know what databases are, don't you? Databases where every single data is stored. And Allah, when before He created this entire alameen, He created the data of this entire alameen into a database, and the name of that database was Lohe Mahfuz. And the four books, the three books that He gave, were, in my own terminology, the way I often like to understand, they were floppy disk versions from the central database. The Torah was a version of the Lohe Mahfuz, not an absolute version, just a copy from the hard disk, some information. The Injil, the Zabur, these were copies of portions of information. But when it came to the Qur'an wasn't a copy of information or a portion of information. The Qur'an was a compression of the entire information of the Lohe Mahfuz. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Qur'an, don't think this Qur'an is just a number of orders or a set of jackanories. Allah says, وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ تِبْيَانٌ كل شيء This Quran has knowledge of everything. Knowledge of? So I ask the question, is there anything the Quran doesn't have knowledge of? Hazrat Ibn Abbas loses the saddle of his horse. If you lose something, if I lose something, we look here, there, everywhere. But when Ibn Abbas loses the saddle of his horse, he opens the Quran, reads a few verses, closes it, and goes and finds the saddle of his horse. Ibn Abbas, how did you find your lost saddle from your from the Quran? He replies, تبيان لكل شيء. This has knowledge of everything. It is my deficit and your deficit that we cannot decompress the information in this Quran. However, the beloved has taught us formulas of how to decompress that information. But we accept that the Quran has knowledge of everything. Fair enough. The Quran has knowledge of? There are milke bolein. The Quran has knowledge of? Then what about the knowledge of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Ar-Rahmanu 'allama al-Quran. Oh my beloved, fear not. Your knowledge is not prone to the trial and error of university, college, or school. Why? Because Rahman has taught the entire Quran to you. Ar-Rahma. Just weigh these two verses together. Tibyanu li kulli shay. Knowledge of everything. Ar-Rahmanu 'allama al-Quran. Beloved, we have given you knowledge of the entire Quran. So the conclusion is that if the Quran has knowledge of everything, it therefore also means beloved has also knowledge of everything. Knowledge of his ummati. So he invites his ummati to his function, to his gathering. The final question that begs to be answered is this. You go and don't go empty-handed. So what have you come today here with? What have you come today here with? What should you take to the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Why should I answer this question? Why should anyone answer this question? Let us ask Allah, oh Allah, you tell us, what is the best way of celebrating the birthday of a Prophet? What is the best way? Oh Allah, you tell us. If you want to know the way Allah has celebrated birthdays, then pick up the Quran. Allah says, وَسَلَامٌ عَلَيْهِ يَوْمَ وُلِدَ وَيَوْمَ يَمُوتُ وَيَوْمَ يُبْعَثُ حَيًّا. Don't think that the birthday of a prophet is an ordinary day. Why? Because Allah, the Lord of the world, reads salam upon them. Only on their birthday? No. Salamun ala Musa wa Harun. Salam upon Musa and Harun. Salamun ala Ilyasin. Allah sends salam upon each of his prophet by name. But at one juncture, the ocean of Rahmah comes into a different mode and he says, Salamun alal mursaleen. Salam upon all my prophets. That Lord who sends salam upon his prophets in the ordinary course, in the ordinary course, he specifies the day of birth of his beloveds and he says, although I read every day, 365 days of the year, although I read all the time salam upon my beloveds, but I specify a specific salam on the birthday of my prophets. And hence the Quran says that on the birthday of Yahya alayhi salam, on the birthday of Isa alayhi salam, Allah, the Lord of the world, sends salam upon them. So the conclusion is, what better gift can you give to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on his birthday other than to read salam upon him? Now, I just want to mention 2 points and inshallah we'll conclude. The first point is, what is the response of this salam? Yeah? What is the? Now, no doubt you know that when you go to a graveyard, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, don't just turn your face thinking there's just a pile of mud. Why? You should say, Assalamu alaikum ya ahl al-qubur. O people of the grave, salam upon you. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ says, when you say salam to them, they respond to your salam. Not only respond to your salam, they see you, recognize you, and then they respond to your salam. So a reciprocal salam is very good. We say salam, the Prophet says salam. Lekin is baat mein maza nahi hai. Ke we say and we receive back what we got. Maza is baat mein hai ke we give something of inferior quality because we are inferior, but we receive something of superior quality. So let me give you an example of the superior quality of salam of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the final question that needs to be answered is, can a prophet in his grave or can someone from his grave give benefit? That's the last thing. And we'll conclude. Are you all here? 100%? I haven't lost you. What was I talking about? This is a way of finding out whether you're just saying Subhanallah, Subhanallah. Lunchtime is approaching. You're more concerned about the excellent food, mashallah. May Allah bless those who put so much effort into cooking such beautiful food. Look at that. Everyone eats it and only few people say Ameen. Everyone say Ameen. Your Ameen goes a long way, not only for those who cook, but creates more barakah in their cooking. Anyway, now, the final two questions are this. What is the nature of reciprocal salam when we give to the Prophet? You see, if you say, we give salam to the Prophet, he gives it us back. Fine. Well, the person in the grave does that anyway. So what's the significance of the salam of the Prophet on return? Shall I tell you the significance of the salam? The Prophet said, when anyone, when? When?
Anyone.
I need you with me here.
Anyone.
When anyone reads salam upon me. Reads? What happens? When anyone reads salam upon me, فَرَدَّ إِلَيَّ رُوحِي, Allah returns my soul to my body, and when my soul is back in my body, I say salam to him. What a beautiful saying. Tell me, now we are saying salam, people on the other side are not. When we are not, they are. In namaz we say salam. After namaz we say salam. Is there a time when someone is not reading salam on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Okay, maybe clinically it can be proven that there could be some minutes or seconds in the day when humans don't read salam. But then humans are not the only ones who read salam. Jinns read salam. Angels read salam. You've heard that, haven't you? 70,000 in the morning and 70,000 in the... And then when angels read or don't read, jinns read or don't read, humans read or don't read, Allah himself reads. And so therefore, can it not be concluded when the Prophet says, anyone who reads salam upon me, my soul returns to my body and then I respond to him. Is there any time when someone is not reading salam on the Prophet? And if there is no time when salam is not being read on the Prophet, it means there is no time when his soul is not back in his body to say wa alaykum as-salam. This hadith which I've presented to you is not an inauthentic hadith. This hadith has been approved by Ibn Taymiyyah. So therefore, we are not quoting you a hadith that is unreliable. Even the adversary accepts that this is a valid hadith. Even the adversary accepts the function of the body of Muhammad Rasulullah. Don't think that that body lay dormant in Gumbat-e-Khizra. That body is active, as active can be. Why? Because it responds positively to the salam of everyone who sends salam upon him. And now the final question remains. Salam for salam. Okay, the soul returns to the body. But that's for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What about for us? Can we actually receive benefit from the people of the grave? That's the crucial question. And I think we'll finish on this because, you see, it's all very well saying, yes, he's alive, yes, he's in his grave. But the question that really needs to be asked is someone who goes in his grave, who is cut off from the world, who we cannot see, who we cannot hear, can that person benefit us? My simple answer to this, and a very effective answer, is those people who do not believe in help from the grave or the people of the grave, my humble advice is they should not pray 5 times salah. They should give up their salah 5 times. Why? Because 5 times prayer was not ordained by Allah in the beginning. What was ordained by Allah was 50 salah. How many? So how did it get down? Allah was the giver. Inna Allah la yukhliful mi'ad. Allah doesn't change his promise. Wa la tabdila li kalimatillah. Allah doesn't change his words. But the Lord gives 50. And the beloved takes 50. There's no quibble or qualm. You give 50, I take 50. But when he returns, there was a person who was in his grave. There was a person who was in his... Do you know who this person was? Sayyidina Musa Kalimullah. And Kalimullah said, oh beloved, what do you come with? He says, I come with 50. He says, go back. Now the Prophet ﷺ would have said, excuse me, my ummah, hello, Allah has given me the command. Where's the connection with you? I am harisun alaykum bil mu'mineen. I care for my ummah the most. Why are you interfering? You're in the grave. People of the grave cannot help. But no, the Prophet said, doesn't matter. Kaleem, if you say, I'll take your words back to Allah. And so therefore, he went back and then Allah said, okay, fair enough. It's my friend Kaleem. You know how they say, this will happen. Oh, but it's all right, he's my friend. It's only Kaleem, no problem. 50, 45. Yalla, did you not know that we were going to end up with 5? Of course he did. But no, he says 45. What's the game? What's the catch? Baat nahi samajh aa rahi. Jo yahan baithe hain baat nahi samajh aa rahi. What's the catch? From 50, he doesn't come down to 5. He comes to 45. And then he comes with 45 again. He says, Kaleem, 45. You all right? No, go back. So he goes back. Who is the benefactor of the ummah? Kaleemullah or Habibullah? But look at the roles. Look at the role play. Look at the scheme. He's saying, okay, I'll go back. So he goes back. And not 40, from 45 to 5, 45 to 40. And then again and again and again. I want to ask you a question. If you have a house in the side street there, can anybody stop you from going there? You sure? That's on the condition that if there's a non-turbulent ceasefire in the home. You know what I mean. Especially the married people. May Allah give stability to all married homes. Now, if this is your house, can somebody stop you from going in and out? But if it's the house of your neighbor, can you go in and out as you please? You need permission, right? Now, when Kaleemullah said, oh Habibullah, go back, he didn't say, no, 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 I haven't been invited. I need permission. He went back, came back, went back, came back, went back. What was he showing? He was showing, Kaleem, when you went on your miraj, you went by invitation. And you went to another's house. But I go back and come back, go back and come back to show that this is not a foreign house for me. This is common territory for me. This is common. Tu kisi aur ke ghar gaya tha. Main apne pyare ke ghar ja raha hoon. And so therefore, the principle that was established on the night of Miraj was that people of the grave not only benefit you once, but they benefit you again and again. And if our master took assistance from Kaleemullah, although he had a greater standing in the eyes of Allah than Kaleemullah, what he wanted to teach his ummah, if I can seek recourse to this course of action by seeking help from the people of the grave, and the people of the grave can give me help, therefore seek help from the people of the grave, for this is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So today we have 5 namaz because of the wasila of the person of the grave known as Musa Kaleemullah. I know some people think in themselves, they think, you know what? Kaleemullah, you interceded on our behalf so many times. When it got to 5, why didn't you just say it once more? Finished. But no, actually, just for your information, Kaleemullah actually did that. We've got him to thank for, you know. We weren't even born and he was thinking about us. You know, Kaleemullah wasn't thinking about the Sahaba. He knew that these people who give up their lives, give up everything for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you say to them 50, they're going to say, no problem. But he wasn't thinking about them, he was thinking about us. He was saying, these guys are going to struggle. And look at his vision. 1400 years ago, he looked at our working lives, our domestic situations, and he says, these guys are going to suffer with 5. So even Act 5, he says, go back. The Prophet ﷺ says, no. Now even I cannot go back on this one, even though I'm tempted to do so. What I'm trying to say to you is that the idea of the continuity of attention, tawajjuh, of people in their graves is a phenomena that is part and parcel of the Quran and the Sunnah. Our five prayers are an emblem to that assistance which Kalimullah gave us 1400 years ago. Tell me with your iman, if Kalimullah can sit in his grave and he can help us, then what is the nature of help of Habibullah? What is the nature of help? I'm conscious of the time. We've concluded. But the conclusion of my discussion is this, and this is the real point which I want to make. Don't take the day of Milad to be a customary day. It is a day which is designed for the Ummati to connect with the Nabi. For the Ummati to connect with the Nabi. And that is why the message of this Milad is, bring those people who are in the wider community, who are not familiar with the nature of the mercy and rahmah of Rahmatul Lil Alameen. Bring them closer. I'll just give you one example and we'll conclude from this. We invited a non-Muslim to a Milad. He was a lawyer. A non-Muslim lawyer. He's still alive in England, you can meet him. We invited a non-Muslim to a Milad. He came. And this non-Muslim, before Salah, we invited a non-Muslim to a Milad. And a few days later, he came to his office in the morning and he said to his Muslim colleagues, I want to be a Muslim. How? He said, when I attended the Milad, I heard so many things about this person known as Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that it inspired me that how could a person exist with such qualities and such caliber? And I was thinking, and it got me thinking, until last night, I saw someone in my dream. And I said to him, who are you? He said, my name is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I am your prophet and I have come to take you with me. He said, I went to the library this morning. And he said, I opened a book on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said, I looked at the description of his face. And he says, the same face that I saw in my dream last night was the same face that was described in the book in the morning. He became a Muslim. What I'm trying to tell you is this, that invite the wider community to these functions. Why? When they hear the majesty and the glory of your beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that will be the beginning of the connection process between them and their prophet. And hence Milad is the name of connecting with the Ummati and with the Prophet. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ.
Subhanallah walhamdulillah.